Good afternoon, everybody. This is the last lecture of the series on foundations. Okay. So in the last lecture, I will concentrate on equivalence relation. But before that, I hear that during your breakout sessions in the morning session, many of you are not reached up to inverse images. But let me tell you that it's one of the most important concepts. And even MSc students do not understand properly. Okay. So I would request you to spend some time, go through it, possibly in the breakout room today. Okay. Because most of you, because of group theories, you have some kind of confidence in equivalence relation. So that may not require too much of a revision for you. But inverse images is more important. So I suggest all of you go through it again. Do you understand me? Yes. All right. If necessary, you can spend a little more time with the coordinators today so that you learn it thoroughly. So, as a kind of a reminder, let us go back to what I did in the morning. Okay. So, we had, let me have the same kind of picture. So this was my B, this was my Y, this was B complement, that is Y minus B.
So please share your screen.
I have to share, I have not done that, yes. Okay, then what do I have? I have this, this is F inverse of B, and this is X, therefore this is X minus F inverse of B. What do I want to say? This is same as saying F inverse of B complement. This object is nothing other than this. What do I want to claim? I want to claim this object is this. Do you understand this? Where the C is? F inverse B is a subset of X. Take the complement. It says B is a subset of this. Take a complement on Y. Then take F inverse. We want to say these two are equal. Okay. So let us quickly go through the proof so that you first let us recall when an element X belongs to F inverse B, this is an if and only by definition Fx belong to B. Therefore, when does an X does not belong to F inverse B? Since it's an if and only, it is same as Fx not in B. Do you understand these two statements? If you want, you can put a X dash, because there are always students, they think it should be different symbol. Okay. Right. So what do I want to prove? I want to prove this thing. That is X minus F inverse B equal to F inverse of Y minus B. Right. So let us start with an X. Okay. X belong to this. If and only if X belong to X and X is not in, sorry, X is not in F inverse B. Right? It is here, but not here. Is that okay? But this is same as saying X is in X and X is not in F inverse B. Just now we saw that. That means Fx is not in B. You follow that? Now, X is, this is immaterial, okay? This is not a condition because X is always there. So, Fx is not in B. So, what does that mean? That means Fx is in Y, but not in B. But this is if and only if X belongs to F inverse of Y minus B. That's it. We have proved it. I'll give it 15 seconds. Go through it. Try to imagine X is here. That means what? X must be here and X is not here. That's what I am writing. That means again, X is in here, but X is not in F inverse B is same as Fx is not in B. Right? That means, but Fx is always in Y. Therefore, Fx is in Y, but not in B. But that's the definition of X lying in F inverse Y minus B. This is an if and only. Okay? So, I'll keep quiet for about 10 seconds. Once you understand, please say yes quick. Still, they are struggling. Okay. So, just go back to what I said yesterday. Just because you learn functions and sets, your teachers believe that they don't know to teach you how to do it properly. They immediately jump into real analysis, algebra, and topology. Okay. Then they prove F is continuous, if and only if inverse image of an open set is open. They don't even define how carefully inverse image. They don't make you understand carefully. Then they prove this. F is continuous, if and only if inverse image of a closed set is closed. Right? At least 30 of you must have already gone through matrix space topology in your final year BSc. Am I right? Clear, everybody? How many of you have gone through that? Now you are struggling. Okay, this should be a kind of an eye opener for the teachers who are here and who are watching elsewhere. Okay, that's enough. Okay, please review all these things. Let's go back. Now I'm going to talk about equivalence relation. So, as I said, in the morning, my idea is to kind of make you think in abstract mathematics also with confidence. So, I could immediately jump into equivalence relation, but let's define what is meant by relation. Suppose when I say A is a son of B, or let us say X, because there is a A here, X is a son of Y, right? This is the kind of relation we talk about. We also say Y is. Now I can't say, yeah, remember that? That is because of English, right? O is father of X, right? Now, do you see something very interesting? When I say relation, it is, there is an arrow, that is X is related to Y, okay? What is the relation? X is the son of Y, but Y is not related to X using the same relation. O is not a son of X, O is the father of X. Do you see that? Therefore, when I want to talk about relation, what I am talking about is the order in which I am saying something is related to something. I want to say X is related to Y. That does not mean Y is related to X, whatever the relation you talk about. Therefore, what you are talking about is ordered pair. This is somewhat vague justification of what I am going to say. Okay. So, in modern mathematics, we define a relation on a set X is a subset R of X cross X. This is a Cartesian product. You understand this? Very simple. Relation is nothing but a subset of X cross X, a relation on X. Do you like it? Yeah? Okay. Now let's try to understand. Okay. Then, what do I say? I say, I denote X, this is, I read it as X is related to Y, if and only if the ordered pair XY belong to R. Okay, this R is called a relation, and I say X is related to Y, look at the ordered pair. Just don't get psyched, we will look at very concrete example, you will understand. Let us look at the simplest example. Okay. Suppose I take a set X and let us look at what is called the diagonal set X. That is my R. What is the R? The diagonal set is all element X and X. If you want to imagine, this is X, this is X, this is X plus X, and this is your diagonal set. All the elements here will be of the form X comma X. You understand this? This is a relation. Now, you give me X1 and X2 in X. When are they related? What do I have to check? X is related to Y if only the ordered pair XY belong to R. That means the ordered pair X1, X2 must be in R. But R consists of only those ordered pairs where the coordinates are equal. Therefore, X1 is related to X2 if and only if X1 equal to X2. Okay. Take 10 seconds. Make sure you understand. Do not resist, okay? It looks abstract or anything. You just learn. It's like you're going to a new place, okay? And try to look at the culture and learn how to work with the culture. Right? If those people only among say want to handshake, you handshake. Except when it's not epidemic, like a COVID. And if you come to India, then you learn to say only vanakkam. Oh, maybe I should say, right? Namaste, namaskara, namaskaram. So you learn the culture. So this is the culture. How many of you understood? At least 35? Not even 30. Hey, you are all lazy then. Huh? You are all waiting. The moment I ask, then they are clicking. If you are lazy, I will also be lazy. I don't know how to teach. Okay. Now let's look at the second example. Now let's look at X equal to R. Let me change the pawn now. Okay. And this is my line. The picture. It's very difficult for me to draw a picture. Okay. Ah, good. This is Y equal to X line. And my set R is everything above this line. You understand this? Yeah. How many of you understand? Look at the line Y equal to X, the diagonal line. Okay. The points on the line are not included. Only everything strictly above that, this side. Okay. They are included. That is my subset. Do you understand the subset? Quick. Right. Very good. Now, what is the relation? Now let me look at a point, let me say, this point 5 comma 4, can it be here? This is 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 4 will be 1, 2, 3, 4. This is 5. You see that? So when is a point here? Tell me, when a point x comma y, he is in R. How many of you know the answer? Quick. Call somebody out, please. Group 1. Am I not audible?
You are audible, sir.
Why then no response? I said group Pritham. 1.
Pritham. Calling like Ankita.
Y greater than equal greater than X.
What is it? You are right. Please say it aloud. I am unable to hear properly.
If Y greater than X.
Y greater than X. Right?
Yeah.
Is that what she said?
Yes.
since we wrote in terms of x and y, let me say x less than y. Okay, therefore what is the relation? Now I want to say x is related to y if and only if xy belong to R. That happens if and only if x is less than y. Therefore, what is the relation? This subset. Okay, this is a geometric way of looking, but that's more difficult. I want the usual way. So on the set R, what is the relation I have? The relation is standard relation. What is the standard relation? Give me two real numbers A and B. If A is less than B, that's it. Less than relation is what this subset induces. How many of you understand? Take some time. So this relation induces is nothing other than rather. The less than relation among real numbers. Do you understand? Okay, x is related to y if only ordered pair xy belongs to R. But just now, I don't remember that girl told that happens if only if x is less than y. Therefore, what is the relation? Now, what is the relation here? We already saw what is the diagonal set on any set induces a relation. What is the relation? That's equality relation, because x1, x2, x1 is related to x2 if only if x1, x2 belong to R. That happens if only if x1 equal to x2. That means this R, this diagonal set, the relation is nothing other than the equality relation. See, equality you may not think of as a relation, right? Equality relation. This is the first example, and the second example is equivalence relation. Are you happy now? Okay. How many of you understand these two examples? Please clear. Yeah. How many of you understand? Say it again. Good. Okay. So this abstract way of defining relation, I gave you two examples so that you can understand it better. All right. Now, if you want third example, I can give, but then I will not be able to get you to equivalence relation. So let me stop here. So let x be a set. Hereafter we will only say the R is this is a relation. That means there is an R in x cross x, and therefore x is related to y if only if x comma y is an R. Okay. So even though this is a definition, we will use only this way. Okay. So let this be a relation on the set x. Then I want to say first, okay, the relation is reflexive. Reflexive meaning you can see yourself. That means x is related to itself. This should be true for all x. What does that mean? This means the ordered pair x comma x should be in R. This is true for all x. What does this mean? That means the diagonal subset must be a subset of R. Do you understand this? Quick. No, I am clearing everybody. Please say again. Yes or no? It was cleared. Please, all of you try again. Okay. Earlier it was 50. Now it shows only 44. Okay. Then I want to say it's reflexive. Sorry, symmetric. Okay. This is symmetric. What does that mean? If x is related to y, okay, then y is related to x. Yeah. What does this mean? X is related to y, that means the ordered pair xy is in R. That should imply the ordered pair yx is in R. Do you follow that? Now let's go back to those two examples which I did now. Is equality relation reflexive? Yes or no? It's reflexive because x is related to itself. How many of you understand? Let's look at less than relation. Is it reflexive? X is related to Y if and only if X is less than Y. Therefore, X is related to X if and only if X is, remember, it's not less than or equal to, strictly less than. X is less than X. That's wrong. Therefore, what do I know? Equality relation is reflexive, whereas less than relation is not reflexive. How many of you understand? Clear all, please. I think it's a so equality relation is reflexive, whereas less than relation is not reflexive. Now let's look at symmetry. Okay, is equality relations symmetric? If X is related to Y, is Y is related to X? How many of you think it is correct? If X is equality relation is symmetric, how many of you think? Yeah. Somebody said no. Can you call out one of them who said no? Quick.
Didish.
Yes, sir.
It is. Why not, it's not reflexive?
Sir,
not symmetric. Sorry, I am talking about symmetric. Quick.
So, if it is symmetric, then Y is greater than X, and in this case,
look, we are talking about equality relation, man. The first example.
Oh.
Is it symmetric or not?
Sir, it is symmetric.
Still, there is somebody who says no. Who is that? I think after lunch, for all of us, it's a kind of a little drowsy. Eh? The reaction is very slow.
It is. And I changed.
Okay. So it's a reflexive. Why? If you say X is related to Y, it simply means X equal to Y. Therefore, Y is also related to X. You understand? Therefore, equality relation is reflexive and symmetric. And the third, whereas let's look at the less than relation. If X is related to Y, it says in less than X is less than Y. Okay. Does it mean Y is related to X? Law of trichotomy says it cannot happen. Because if X is less than Y, then Y cannot be less than X. Do you understand this? We are using law of trichotomy here to say the less than relation is not symmetric. How many of you understand? Quick. When you learn like this. Go very slow. Make sure basic concepts are thorough. Then you will never have any doubt. Okay? Right. Now, third condition is this is transitive. What does it mean? Suppose X is related to Y and Y is related to Z. Okay? X, Y, Z are all members of X. Okay? That should imply X is related to Z. Okay? That means what? If I know X comma Y is an R and also Y comma Z is an R, then I can conclude the ordered pair X Z is also in R. Okay, let's go back to the example. Is equality relation transitive? If X is related to Y, that means X equal to Y. Right? And Y is related to Z, that means Y equal to Z. Right? Both are true. What does it mean? X is related to Y, that means X equal to Y, and Y is related to Z, that means Y equal to Z. But Y, since both the conditions are true, that means Y is same as X. Therefore, X, Z is also equal to X. How many of you understand the proof? Quick. So the equality relation is reflexive, symmetric, and transitive. Okay. Very good. Now, how about less than relation? Please, remove, clear all the feedback. Yeah. Is less than relation transitive? Those who think it's transitive, please say yes, quick. Yeah, ask somebody who says no, quick.
Vijay. Oh, he changed.
No, just because I asked him, he changed. I don't think he understood and changed. So let us confirm. Call him out.
Vijay, are you there?
If x is related to y, x must be less than y.
Yeah.
And if y is related to z,
yeah,
y must be less than z.
Yeah.
Then
therefore,
x less than y less than z, then x must be less than z. It
is therefore, s, it is x is related to z, right? Very good. No, you should learn to say that correctly. What you said is correct. You should conclude finally. X is less than Z and hence X is related to Z, because that's our definition. X is related to Y if and only if X is less than Y. We proved X is less than Z. Therefore, X is related to Z. Okay, very good. So, let me write down. I have equality relation. What are the properties it has? It is reflexive, symmetric, and transitive. Okay, whereas the less than relation, is it reflexive? It's not reflexive. Is it symmetric? Not symmetric. Is it transitive? Yes, it is transitive. Do all of you understand this? Why it takes so much of time? We already discussed all these things. I'm simply summarizing. Okay. So, a relation on a set X is an equivalence relation. If this is reflexive, symmetric, and transitive, all the three properties should be true. Okay, so the rest of the lecture is going to be the study of equivalence relation. So, which of these is an equivalence relation? How many of you know which of these two relations is equivalence relation? Quick. Okay. Can you ask somebody? Quick.
GP,
what are the group? Please, it's always good to say which group number so that the next group number will be ready with the candidate.
Priya from
which group?
Priya from G2 group.
No, please say which group.
G2 group.
Yeah, say that. Group 2 name. Therefore, group 3 person should be ready with the next candidate next time. That way we can save time. Yeah, so Priya?
Equality relation.
Equality relation is whereas the less than relation is nowhere near that. Okay, good. Now, I want you to quickly think. Okay, let's look at the set of natural number. That's my set X. I am going to say A is related to B if A divides B. If and only if. Okay, this is my definition of the equivalent, definition of the relation. This is a relation. Quickly say thing, is this an equivalence relation? What are the properties does it have? There are three properties you have to check. Is it reflexive? Is it symmetric? Is it transitive? Quick, all of you, 15 seconds. No, you just have to think about, forget about whether it's an equivalence relation. I'm not asking that. I am asking, okay, you should know the answer, whether it's reflexive, whether it's symmetric, whether it is transitive. That's it. If you know the answer, please say yes. Quick. It takes so much time to decide. Does A divide A? If A divides B, does it say B divides A? If A divides B and B divides C, does it say A divides C? Come on. This is I'm going to 3rd standard, 4th standard question. Except this jargon, they would not know. Yeah. Can you ask somebody? Next, group 3. Quick.
Krishna from group 3.
Yes, sir. Sir, it will be reflexive.
Oh, yes.
And it will be reflexive and other transitive.
It is reflexive.
And other transitive.
Transitive?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Is it symmetric?
No, sir.
So you should say all that. It is reflexive, transitive, but not symmetric. Learn to say the answer precisely. Okay? Good.
Okay, sir.
Very good. So all of you have already learned group theory. All of you would have learned one of the most important examples of equivalence relation. Right? Okay. Let us look at first is geometry exam. You give me point 2y2. I say they are related if and only. Do you understand this? This is a relation. Quickly check whether it's an equivalence relation. Is it reflexive? Is x y?
Sir, there is some audio break.
Yeah, that's a unstable internet. It just showed me it's unstable. Let me go back. Point on R2. X1, Y1 is related to X2, Y2. If one only, the X coordinates are the same. That is X1 equal to. Is it reflexive? Is it symmetric? Is it transitive? Quick, all of you think. Fast. Very slow. Only 28. Can I believe?
40.
What to check? See, when I want to check whether it's reflexive, what should I do? Take the point x, y. Remember, the set x itself is ordered pair. Okay? You understand that? Don't get confused. Okay? X cross y. Is it related to x cross y? It is related to x cross y if only the x coordinates are the same. Therefore, x, y is related to x, y because x coordinates are the same. Next one. If x1, y1 is related to x2, y2, that means x1 must be x2. Is x2, x2 related to x1, y1? Do you understand the question? Because the notation is bothering them. They do not know. This is if only if x1 equal to x2. Do you understand this? That's our condition. Therefore, is this clear? x2, y2 is related to x1, y1. If I want to say this, what should I check? I have to check the x coordinates are the same. Are they same? They are same because you said x1, y1 is related to x2, y2. Do all of you understand? Now suppose x2, y2 is related to x3, y3. What does it say? This x2 and x3 are the same. But these are related. Therefore, x1 and x2 are the same. Therefore, x1 equal to x2 equal to x3. That means x1, y1 is related to x3, y3. How come you cannot do this? That only shows you don't want to think. Come on, clear everybody. Answer quickly. No, I am clearing everybody. Quick. How many of you understand? So what is it? Is it a Nicolaus relation? Okay. If you think it's an equivalence relation, I'm going to ask the next question. So this is my R2. Okay. I have a point, let us say, this is, let us say, 1, 2 comma 1. This is the point I am having. Okay, this is my point x comma y. Okay, so what are all the points x dash y dash such that x dash y dash is related to xy? Do you have a geometric description of this? The point x dash y dash is related to xy, where xy is 2 comma 1, if and only if, therefore you know the geometric description of all the points x dash y dash which are related to x comma y. How many of you know the answer? Quick. This is a 12th standard question. Please think, I am not asking any difficult mathematics or anything. Okay, in principle, I can teach it to a 5th standard student if he is willing to think. Come on, you ask. I give you a point x dash y dash. I say it's related to 2 comma 1. What does it say? Can't you think? Only 47? It's really a pity. You now you see that what kind of college education you are getting? 3 years of BSc. It's really pretty. Only 50s even now. Come on, come on. I even gave you a problem. Okay, let me ask you a question. Is 5 comma minus 1 related to 2 comma 1? Those who did not know, no, please don't say answer. 52 said yes, others do not know. Those others who do not know, please tell me, is 5 comma minus 1 related to 2 comma 1? Think about. Is 2 comma minus 17 related to 2 comma 1? Is 0 comma 0 related to 2 comma 1? Is 2 comma 27 related to 2 comma 1? I am clearing everybody. How many of you know what are those x dash y dash which are related to 2 comma 1? And you should know how to describe that geometrically also. Come on, quick. It's really a pity. So those of you who are teachers amongst here, please notice that. Okay? By saying that I followed Herstein or Lang, I finished the portion, doesn't mean anything. Are now dummied and food. Now you ask somebody, please. Group 4 now. It all take 10 minutes for this stupid question. Huh? I'm really annoyed. Yeah. Group 4, please. Quick.
Shubham from group 4.
So 2 comma y.
So give me a geometric description. What are all the points of the point 2 comma y? You don't have a geometry for that? You see that? What is the point of learning analytic geometry? all the points here will be related to 2 comma 1 and only these points, because their x coordinate must always be 2. Therefore, the set of all points x dash y dash lie on the line x equal to 2. That's the answer. You see that? What madam, what kind of teaching you we are getting? What kind of education we are getting in our country? Solid 10 minutes wasted for this example. Please think. Okay, don't refuse to think. That's what happens. Okay, you are annoyed. Now, how many of you understand now? At least clear everybody, please. How many of you understand? And all of you have learned equivalence classes, right? Equivalence relation. When you learn group theory, huh? So what did you learn? Okay, so this is an equivalence relation. Okay, now let me go to group theory. There also I want to say how much you know. So suppose H is a subgroup of G. Okay, then you understand what is meant by AH. This is the, I don't know, I think it's called left coset. Am I right? This set of all points are for the form AH, where H varies over H. Yes, yeah. So I say A is related to B if and only if AH equal to BH. Is this an equivalence relation? I am not using your A inverse B criterion. Okay. This is much easier. A is related to B if only if left coset of A and left coset of B are the same. Come on. This cannot take time. Is AH equal to AH? If AH equal to BH, is BH equal to AH? If AH equal to BH and BH equal to CH, is AH equal to CH? It takes less than 5 seconds to reflect. So this is an equivalence relation. But you might have seen it in different language. This relation is same as saying A inverse B belong to H. Maybe this is the one all of you will learn. Because, okay, mathematics teachers always want to give a more difficult definition to work with. How many of you know this? If AH equal to BH, what does it mean? Therefore, A belong to AH. Yes? Therefore, A belong to BH. That means A must be of the form B times H1. Similarly, B belong to BH, but BH equal to AH, therefore B belong to AH. Therefore, B is of the form A times H2. Do you understand that? Therefore, A is equal to BH1 and B equal to AH2. Therefore, this is equal to H1. Right? This is good enough. All right? Are you following what I'm saying? B equal to AH, therefore A inverse B is H2 from this. How many of you understand what I did? Because coset also you may not have understood properly. You understand? So what I have proved is AH equal to BH. I proved A inverse B is a group element in the subgroup element. And converse is also true. Suppose A inverse B belong to H, that means A inverse B is of the form some H for H. Now I claim from this, I want to claim AH equal to BH. Why? Any element here is of the form some AH1, right? Any element here is of the form BH2, right? I want to say these two sets are equal. Therefore, I have to say any element here is an element here and conversely. That is, I have to prove AH is contained in BH and I have to prove BH is contained in AH. So, let us prove one way. Start with any element in AH, it is a form AH1. Right? But what do I know from this? A inverse B belong to H. Therefore, A inverse B is H. Therefore, that means B is A times H. Yeah? Therefore, A is BH inverse. Are you following? Therefore, B, H inverse, H1. A is BH inverse. Now, H inverse, H1, both are elements of H. Therefore, this is an element H2 of H. Therefore, it is of the form BH. Therefore, AH1 is of the form BH2. That means it is in BH. Now, interchange A and B, you get the result. I'll pause, review and proceed. Okay, 20 seconds. Because I'm sure you just slept through in the group theory course when this happened. Clear all? Quick. How many of you understand this? Only 45. Anyway, in there is, I think, group theory lectures here in MTTS. You will again have this. Okay. Do you understand this? So what I said, A is related to B if only the coset AH equal to coset BH. That is same as saying the element A inverse B is an element of H. Right? And we have, and this is easier. Using AH equal to BH, we could immediately see this is an equivalence relation. Okay. But what I want to do is, I want to specialize. Okay. So let G equal to Z, additive group of integers. Okay. All of you know this, right? Do you know what are all the subgroups of Z? All of you have gone through group theory, right? In final year BSc. Do you know what are the subgroups of this? I'm clearing everybody. I think I have to do it. Okay. Let's not worry about. Okay. Let H equal to pi times Z. Okay. You can check this as a subgroup. Okay. Right. Therefore, let me try to understand. Okay. Now, suppose A is an element, okay, is an integer, then what is the coset? Remember, this is an additive and this is an abelian group. Therefore, since it's an additive group, AH should be written as A plus H. Do you understand this? And so, A is related to B, A and B are integers, then A is related to B if and only if A plus H equal to B plus H. The left coset A plus H must be equal to the left coset B plus H, but because of commutativity, it does not matter, left and right. Do you understand this? Now let's try to understand something very interesting. But this we saw, this is same as saying A inverse B. What does A inverse B mean? Minus A plus B, which is same as saying B minus A, that belongs to H. How many of you understand this? Quick. Because this kind of thing you may not have heard in group theory. Congruence relation is separate in number theory and cosets are different in group theory. You don't see that there, you can relate them. Do you understand that? Therefore, what do I know? This is a subgroup. This subgroup is determined by 5. You understand? Therefore, I say A is related to B if and only if B minus A is in H. What is B minus A? What is H? It is all multiples of 5. That means this is if and only if B minus A is a multiple of 5. That is if and only if 5 divides B minus A. Do you understand this? So, I am specializing. I am taking the additive group of integers. I am taking the subgroup 5 times Z. Then I want to understand what is the relation just now we looked at. The abstract relation we looked at. We are giving a concrete example. When I work through, that says A is related to B if only A plus H is B plus H. That means B minus A must be in H. A inverse B in the additive notation is minus A plus B, because our commutativity is the same as B minus A. So B minus A must be in H. What is H? All multiples of pi. That means pi must divide B minus A. So A is related to B if only if pi divides B minus A. How many of you understand? Quick. I am clearing all. I want to hear again. How many of you understand this relation now? Good. Okay. Now let us look at. This means pi divides B minus A. What does that mean? That means pi times some m must be equal to B minus A, or B must be of the form A plus pi times A. Okay, there exists m in integer such that this happens and this happens. Yeah. Therefore, if I take, let us say, 11 as my A, and if I want to say B is related to A, can you guess what should be B? Let me make my life easy, or your life easy. If I say A equal to 1, and if I say A is related to B or B is related to A, they are same because symmetry. Can you guess what should be B? It says B must be of the form 1 plus 5 times M. So what does it say about B? How many of you can see? Now I made life easy for you. What does it say about B? B, when divided by 5, should leave remainder 1. You understand this? Therefore, if I take A equal to 1, and if I say B is related to A, then B, this happens if and only if B, when divided by 5, leaves 1 as the remainder. How many of you understand this? Quick. Very good. So these are the things, you know, in group theory you would not have gone through, because they are all worried about abstract things. Now let us take A equal to 12. When I say B is related to A, what does it mean? That means B minus A must be 5 times N. That means B must be equal to A plus 5 times N. But this A is 12 5 times N. But remember, 12 I can already write it. 12 I can write as 2 times 5 plus 2 plus 5 times M. Therefore, this is 2 plus 5 times M plus 2. Therefore, B is related to A if and only if. Can somebody complete this? So all of you thought you know equivalence relation, right? Because of group theory.
Shraddha, group number 5. If B is related to A, if and only if B when divided by 5, remainder is 2.
Very good. Okay. During discussion hour, you play with this, try to understand this better. Now I am ready to define what is meant by equivalence class. Because I have another 20 minutes, I would like to finish this as, let me look at one more, sorry. The most important example, this is an example which teachers usually don't do, I keep on insisting. Suppose f is a function from x to y. right? Okay, x could be anything, y could be anything, f could be any function. I don't care what it is. Now I say x1 is related to x2 if and only if they have the same images. F of x1 equal to f of x2. How many of you think it's an equivalent solution? Quick. Please clear. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. How many of you think it's an equivalent solution? Is x related to x? If x1 is related to x2, is x2 related to x1? If x1 is related to x2, x2 is related to x3? Is x1 related to x3? They are all very easy. You should immediately see. If x1 is related to x2, fx1 equal to fx2. X2 is related to x3, fx2 equal to fx3. Therefore, fx1 equal to fx3. That means x1 related to x3. Come on. In my class, you have to learn to think and think. Okay, if you stay focused, it's easy. So this is an equivalence relation. You understand that? So this is an equivalence relation. This is very important. Okay, whenever you have, you learn a lot of things, but very vaguely, quotient groups, quotient ring, quotient modules, quotient spaces, any kind of quotient constructions have something to do with this. Okay, directly or indirectly. So you should learn this equivalence relation. Okay, now let me ask you a question. Suppose f from x to y is a 1-1 function. Okay, I get an equivalence relation, right? For any function f, I get an equivalence relation. For this 1-1 function also, I get an equivalence relation. How many of you can guess what is this equivalence relation? Pick. I'll give you 20 seconds. Go slow. Make sure. When is x1 related to x2? That's the question you have to ask. If it's a 1-1 function, x1 is related to x2, but you know what is the definition of x1 related to x2. From that, you should be able to conclude. Quick. See, these are the abstract thinking. It helps you concentrate and have confidence, immense confidence. Only 21. Really pretty. Okay, next group, please ask, because the time is running out.
Anshika,
group 6, Anantha.
X1 equal to X2.
So what is the relation? We have a name for that.
Equality relation.
Exactly. If F is 1-1, this relation is nothing other than equality relation. I don't know why you have problem. When is X1 related to X2? That's a question you should ask. This is by definition fx1 equal to fx2. But what do I know about the function? Yeah, f is 1-1. Okay, this implies x1 must be equal to x2. And this if and only if I can go back. Okay, for this implication, I need f is 1-1. For this is always true. Therefore, x1 is related to x2 if and only if x1 equal to x2. That's the equality relation. Why don't you say that? Only 34 can say that. Do you see? You refuse to think. And if you are one of those fancy institutes where you paid through your nose, you should ask for a fee refund. Okay. So let X be a set. This is an equivalence relation. Okay. Now start with any element A in this. This is a subset I want to define. This is a subset of X. This is, I'll call it equivalence class of A. So how do I define this subset? I should always give set of conditions. When does X belong to the equivalence class of A? If and only if X is related to A. You understand this? Yeah? Right. So then this is called equivalence class of A. How many of you understand this now? This is a definition. Yeah. Now let's look at examples. So on R2, I define an equal relation. Do you remember x1, y1 related to x2, y2, if and only if x1 equal to x2. And we also saw if I give a point A comma B, what is the equivalence class? X comma y is related to A comma B, if and only if x equal to A. Therefore, the moment the first coordinate is always A, I don't care what y is, that point will be related to A comma B. Therefore, the equivalence class is nothing other than if this is my A comma B and this is my A, the equivalence class is the line x equal to A. This is what we saw, 1 comma 2 or whatever it is, 2 comma 1. How many of you understand this? Quick. I already built this example earlier. You see that equivalence classes is highly geometric. You understand this? Yeah. Now, what are the equivalence classes? Do you also see the equivalence classes? Suppose I have another equivalence class through something. Okay. Let me look at some other thing. This is an equivalence class. This is an equivalence class. This is an equivalent class. You see that, what do you see? The pattern. This doesn't look nice, but you know. So, what are the equivalence classes? Equivalence classes are given by x equal to A line. Do you understand that? Now, there are lines parallel to the y axis. So, what do you know about parallel lines? Either they do not meet or they are the same. You understand? Do you understand? How many of you understand what I'm saying? What are all the equivalence classes? Equivalent classes are lines parallel to the y-axis. Okay. The equivalence class of A comma B is the line x equal to A. Right? And therefore, if you take two equivalent classes, what can happen? Can they have one point in common? If they have one point in common, then the lines are the same. Because they are, those two are parallel lines. Therefore, they have to be the same. Or, they don't have any point in common. How many of you understand this? Have you thought about equivalence classes geometrically earlier? Right? You would already known. Given two equivalence classes, either they are disjoint or they are the same. That's what we are saying. That's because it's a parallel. The lines are parallel. That's a geometric interpretation. Right? Let's look at one more example. Let's look at the third example. Suppose f is a function from x to y, any function, not injective, not one one, any. Okay. What are the equivalence classes? Equivalent class of x. Can you describe geometrical? Can you describe this? It's really easy. Let me call it A. A in x. So that you can use x as an arbitrary element. Can you describe this set of all x in x? How many of you can write this set, the equivalence class of A? Go back to the definition. When x1 is equivalent to x2. X1 is equivalent to x2 if only fx1 equal to x2. Therefore, what is the equivalence class of A? Set of all x such that, oh my gosh, I give up. They refuse to think. What condition should x satisfy? Come on. If you didn't understand, I think you should quit the course. I'm not asking a difficult question. I'm not asking you to solve something challenging. Apply the definition. x1 is equivalent to x2 if and only if fx1 equal to fx2. You say x is related to a, that means what condition should it satisfy? Come on, next, ask somebody quick. It's a really am an annoying.
Jay Pritham, group 8.
F of x equal to f of a.
And do you have a description? In terms of what I did in the morning, can you describe this set? Something we talked about, images, inverse images, etc. Can you say what this set is? This set is F inverse of the singleton FA. How many of you? Okay, I claim this. Do you understand? F of A is an element of Y. Therefore, the singleton F of A is a subset of Y. That is your B. Therefore, I can talk about F inverse of that. So, what is this set? When does an element X belong to this? If only if Fx belong to the set. But the set has only one element. That means Fx equal to Fa. Therefore, this equivalent class of A is nothing other than the inverse image of the singleton set Fa. I'll give you 20 seconds. Okay. After that, you please say yes if you understand. Everybody can be clear. Now let me ask a specific question now. Suppose I further assume F from X to Y is 1, 1. Okay. What can you say about equivalence classes of A? How many of you know the answer? We had already looked at this case. So it should be easy. If F is 1, 1, we already said that something. How many of you know the answer? Look at this. Here is I did. See, this is how I become confident about mathematics. Look at some standard cases, check, understand, and these kind of things you won't find in books. The teachers will not even ask. Okay. So you have to ask yourself so that you become confident. So can you ask somebody next? The time is running out, so I want to finish the course.
Group 9, somebody.
Yes, sorry. Chaitanya.
What? Say it loud, please. Okay, ask next. If you see not audible, please ask next.
Shashank.
Singleton A, sir.
Very good. Because X belong to this, if and only if Fx equal to Fa. Since F is 1, 1, that means X must be A. Therefore, the only elements which are related to A are only one element, namely singleton A. Very good. Now, suppose, what should be the next question I should ask? Can somebody guess? Yeah. Sir, ask this person who said 1. Somebody has said yes. Quick. What should be the next question I should ask? Next group, please.
Sakshi, it must be an onto function.
Very good. Excellent. Now you see that this is how you learn to think. Okay. you should always kind of investigate yourself. Don't wait for your teacher to ask, textbook to give an exercise. If you do on your own, you will feel proud and you find an answer. So suppose this is on to. Right? Now what can you say? Is there anything you can say? Just because on to, we have nothing. You understand? I know that's what you choose. This is not going to give us anything interesting. But let's assume it's a constant. That is fx equal to y naught for every x. Now start with an x. Start with an a in x. What is the equivalence class of a? Can somebody answer? Quick.
Group 11. Ekta.
Ekta, yeah. It's a whole of x.
Very good. It is all of x. Right? Very good. The equivalent class of A is all of x. Now let's look at the second example. I have z. I have 5z. This is my g. This is my h. Right? So what did we saw? We saw that, okay, if I take 0 less than r less than 5, that is, what are the remainders when a number is divided? If 5 divides a, I can write 5 as q times 5 plus r, where r is less than or equal to 0 less than or equal to r, strictly less than 5. This is called the division algorithm. You must have used it. Yeah. Okay. For example, in group theory, you need it. I don't know whether your teacher did that. Okay, this is needed. For example, when you want to learn cyclic groups, want to talk about structure of cyclic groups, when you wanted to talk about subgroups of cyclic groups and subgroup of Z, which is also cyclic group, the division algorithm is indispensable, the only tool you need. Okay, anyway, do all of you know this? Do you understand? Take any integer, divide it by 5, then I can always write it A equal to Q times 5 with R, so that 0 less than or equal to R less than 5. And this is unique. What do I mean by unique? If I write A equal to Q1 times 5 plus R1, then Q must be equal to Q1, R must be equal to R1. The important condition is R must be satisfy this condition. 0 less than or equal to R less than 5. Have you seen it? Quick. How many of you have seen this? Don't worry about a proof. You know there is a result. That's all I want to know. Good. Right? So what does this say now? Now let's take R between in this set 0 to 4 because these are the possible remainders, right? Now give me any A. There exists a unique R so that A is related to R. How many of you see this? Give me any integer A. Then there is a unique R where R is in 0 to 4. So that A is related to R. How many of you see this? Because you give me A, I can write uniquely as Q times 5 plus R. Then I want to say A is related to R. That means I have to prove A minus R is in H. But it is in H meaning it must be a multiple of 5. But A minus R is Q times 5. Therefore, this is in H. Do you follow that? How many of you understand what I said? So I will extend it to another 15 minutes, Sukumar. See, what I want to say is give me any A, then there exists a unique R, so that A is related to R. R must be between 0 and 4. 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, one of them, and unique. why it is true? Use division algorithm. A must be out of form q times phi plus r. Q and r are unique, right? Therefore, what is a minus r? Q times phi. That means it's a multiple of phi. Phi divides a minus r. That means a is related to r. That's it. Why does it take so much time? Because you are not forced to think in a classroom, so you find it difficult. How many of you understand? Quick. Now tell me how many equivalence classes are there then. Therefore, the equivalent classes are only 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are the equivalent class. Because you give me any integer, either it has to be in this equivalent class or in this or in this, in this or in this. And it's unique. And these are what you call congruence classes. How do they look like? This will look like 8 r times m times 5, where m varies over integer. And no, this is nothing other than the coset r plus 5z. And this coset is nothing other than arithmetic progression, starting from r, and common difference is 5, and common difference goes, in high school, common difference always goes positive side, here it also goes negative side. So your coset of algebra is nothing other than an arithmetic progression here. So I taught you some group theory also on the way, hopefully. How many of you are convinced there are only 5 equivalence classes? Even though there are infinite set, okay, there are only 5 equivalence classes. Each equivalence classes, okay, yeah, there are only 5. Give me any A, it has to be in this equivalence class or in this equivalence class and this. And these are all pairwise disjoint. Why they are disjoint? Because you take any A here and any B here, then when I divide A, it must leave 0. When I divide B, it must leave remainder 1. And by the uniqueness part of the division algorithm, when I take, if you say, are you following what I'm saying? Sometimes, you know, I'm really worried because you are unable to think. See, this means when A is divided by 5, it leaves 0 remainder. A belongs to this. That means when A is divided by 5, it leaves the remainder 1. But I know when A is divided by 5, it has a unique remainder. Do you understand? Therefore, there cannot be any A common to any two congruence classes. These are called congruent classes. Congruent classes, number theory, this is nothing other than the coset in group theory. Okay. Anyway, since I'm also getting exasperated, so let me finish. So let X be a set. This is an equivalence relation. Now what I want to prove is what all of you know. Give me two equivalence classes X and Y. Either they are disjoint or they are equal. Okay. The proof is very easy. Okay. Do you remember what I said yesterday? When you want to say there is a hypothesis, and it implies either S1 holds or S2 holds. How do I give a proof? This is a proof. This is a theorem. Theorem, okay, has a hypothesis. Then conclusion is either S1 is holds or S2 is true. Then how do I prove? If S1 is true, there is nothing for me to prove. So let me assume S1 is not true. Then I have to prove S2 is true. Do you remember? I said it yesterday evening. Right? Now give me two equivalence classes. I have to say they are either their intersection is empty or they are equal. So if their intersection is empty, there is nothing for me to prove. So let me assume that the intersection is not empty. So that means there is a Z common. Now what do we want to prove? The equivalent class of X equal to the equivalent class of Y. What does that mean? You start with any T, that is equivalence class of X, equal to equivalence class of Y. This is what I want to prove. When are two sets equal? That means I have to prove equivalence class of Y, X is a subset of equivalence class of Y, and equivalent class of y is a subset of equivalent class of x. This is what I want to prove. So if I prove this, interchange x and y, you will get this. So let us prove this. So suppose t belongs to equivalence class of x, I want to prove t belongs to the equivalent class of y. Do you understand this? Please bear with me. Okay. After 3 minutes, you won't hear me. I'll stop. Now t belongs to equivalent class of x. I want to say t is y. Right? Now notice that t belongs to equivalent class of x. That means t is related to tx. Now what is the hypothesis? Hypothesis said z is a common element in the equivalent class. Therefore z belongs to equivalent class of x. That means z is equivalent to x. Do you understand this? Now the equivalence relation is symmetric. Therefore this is same as x is related to z. Now I said t is related to tx and I know x is related to z. Therefore I conclude t is related to z. How many of you understand this proof? This part, I have not completed the proof up to this point. See, this kind of abstraction you had already gone through, so you are happy, right? Or you just want to placate me? You understood? Therefore, if t belong to the equivalence class of x, what I have concluded? T belong to equivalence class of x implies t is equivalent to z. Is that all right? Now, what do I know about z? Z also lies in the equivalence class of y. Therefore, I know z is related to y, right? Therefore, now let us combine these two. T is related to z and z is related to y. Therefore, that shows t is related to y. This implies t belongs to equivalent class of y. Therefore, I started with an arbitrary element t in the equivalent class of x and I showed it belongs to the equivalent class of y. Therefore, equivalence class of x is subset of equivalent class of y. Now interchange x and y, you will get the other way around. So what you have shown is, once I have an equivalence relation, the set of equivalent classes, okay, gives rise to a partition of the set x. Okay, but I have not defined partition, but that can wait. I will stop sharing.